Start with the lesson of today, that is 18th of May 2020. So actually, the last time we talked about the design of small channels, very basically. So now we need to think about the case in which the channel is not able to convey the water discharge. So we need first to make a reminder about small channel design, and then we need to switch to another concept that is related to the convenience capability. Convenience can be translated into diciamo capacità di deflusso, compatibilità idraulica in italiano, diciamo in linea generale. And then if the small channel is not able to convey the design water discharge, we have to solve this problem. So we need or to increase the size of the channel, or on the other hand, we need to decrease the water discharge that must flow into the river. So we need, in this second case, to think about a way in order to decrease the water discharge. I mean, it is possible to deploy a kind of hydraulic structure that is able to subtract a part of the water discharge and make possible the flow in another small channel. Then we need to talk about spillways actually. That is a kind of hydraulic structure that is able to subtract a portion of the water discharge from the river, more or less, very basically. Quindi nella sostanza oggi, partendo dal dimensionamento dei canali che abbiamo fatto l'altra volta, volete erodibili, inerodibili o erodibili, è possibile non soltanto dimensionare un canale, ma è anche possibile determinare se un canale esistente, diciamo così, è capace di far defluire la portata di progetto. Questo è un po' il concetto. Quindi nel caso in cui non si verifichi il fatto che il canale è in grado di di convogliare la portata di progetto, abbiamo due strade: o facciamo il canale più grande oppure diminuiamo la portata. Nel primo caso già sappiamo esattamente cosa fare, perché li sappiamo dimensionare, quindi sappiamo anche quanto farlo più grande. Nel secondo caso, cioè se volessimo in linea di principio diminuire la portata, abbiamo bisogno di sottrarla al canale. E quindi abbiamo bisogno di uno sfioratore a superficie libera, che in inglese si chiama proprio spillways, spillway, plurale spillways. Quindi oggi dobbiamo capire da una parte il modo in cui identifichiamo questa criticità, cioè che il canale non è in grado di far defluire questa portata, e poi dobbiamo parlare degli spillway, cioè delle opere che possono essere realizzate per sottrarre una portata al deflusso, ad esempio in un fiume. So we need to start, first of all, to talk about, again, once again, to the definition of the water discharge. So, first of all, we need to recall how we can define the design water discharge. And then how we can in principle verify if channel is hydraulically sufficient. So I mean, if the channel is large enough in order to make possible the conveyance of the design water discharge. So in general, as you know, we start from a return period by means of a series of statistical analysis based on a series of observations, either of rainfall depth or, if you want, of directly of water discharge, if the stochastic variable can be, if the data may be intended as extracted by the same stochastic variable, we can get either the maximum value of the water discharge or the whole hydrograph. So as you can remember, we have the time, we have the hydrograph, so we can have the whole time series of the water discharge, or on the other hand, only the maximum value. Maximum value. The last lecture we have seen how this water discharge can be used to design small channel. So we talked about the design of channel, but actually we can have also an existing channel. So in general we can have a given section shape, and this shape can be known if a topographic bathymetric survey is performed, but in general we can know the shape of the section, and of course also the dimension. Then by using the normal flow hypothesis, so we have this one, we have this one, 2, 3, slope of the bed power 1 over 2, we can in general ask if this section is able to convey the design water discharge. And this is not a complex task. Indeed, we can estimate the roughness coefficient, we can get the function of the water depth giving the extension of the wetted area. In the same way, we can get the function giving the hydraulic radius for varying water depth, and then we can compute from this equation the value of the water depth related to the water discharge. Actually, I can use not Y max, but Y design. So this is the w design water discharge, and based on this value, we can get the value of the water depth related to this water discharge by using the normal flow hypothesis or assumption. So in general, we are using the normal flow equation not to design a new channel, but in order to verify if this channel is able to convey the design water discharge. So we need to compare the extension, or if you want, the height of the section, against the water depth related to the design water discharge. So of course, if YD is lower, is lower than H, remember H is the total depth of the section. YD is the water depth related to the design water discharge. So in this case, we are okay. Indeed, this section is able to convey the water discharge, the design water discharge. Otherwise, if YD is higher than H, indeed the normal flow assumption is violated. We cannot assume that the flow is normal because a kind of overland flow occurs during the flow, during the flood. So we need to correct the shape to solve the problem. We need to make hydraulically sufficient the existing channel. So we have, as we said, two ways. So if the water depth is higher than the height of the section, we need to increase the section. So we need to come back to the design of a new channel, a new small channel. So we need to use the design, we can use A, the design of small channel. That was the topic of the last lecture. So we need to increase the dimension of the section, the size of the section, in order to make it able to convey the water discharge. So QD is the design load, design load, and then we can, just for example, think to deploy a kind of section in which this is the water depth, this is the freeboard. So we need to modify the geometry, the configuration of the channel. So of course this is only one of the possible solutions. The second one is to decrease the incoming water discharge. This is the second option, incoming QD. Actually, this is not so trivial to understand. Indeed, we can have a kind of river. You can have a river. Of course, along this river, the design water discharge flows. So the design water discharge, remember, can be written as a whole hydrograph or characterized by only the maximum value of the water discharge. But anyway, we have a value of the design water discharge. Now, if we understand that the section is too small in order to convey water discharge, we can have a series of possible solutions. So in order to decrease this one, so to decrease the design water discharge, you can think that this is a kind of urban area for which it is important that the flow occurs within the channel and no overland flow must occur. So we need to decrease the incoming water discharge. One of the possibilities is to deviate vuoto di scarico. Star. In order to make the flow, to decrease the flow here with this quantity. So we need first of all to understand which is the water discharge that we need to subtract to the incoming discharge, and then we need to understand how to deploy this structure. So we can make an additional wave channel like this one, in which the water discharge Q star flows and bypass the urban area that we need to protect. Or if we are close to the sea, we can say like this one, this is the sea, this is a river, here we have the incoming water discharge, here we can have a kind of urban area. If the section close to the urban area does not suffice to convey the design water discharge, we can think to deviate part of the water discharge, we can say Q star, in order to decrease the water discharge flowing into the urban area, and the subtracted water discharge is conveyed directly to the sea. So we are deploying a kind of new river that is aimed to convey the water a portion of the total water discharge in order to decrease the water discharge flowing in the channel that pass through the urban area. So as you can understand, the problems from an hydraulic point of view in this case is one, the design of this flume, design of channel. So this blue line must be designed. We need to employ the methods that we described the last time in order to design the wave flume that must be capable of conveying the water discharge Q star. But we have also another problem. The problem is this one. That is the deviation, a kind of the deviation. So we need to design the so-called spillway. The spillway is a structure that can be used to subtract a water discharge, a portion of the water discharge from a main river. But actually, this is not only the only solution to this problem. Indeed, again, if we have a river in which a water discharge QD is defined, here we have the urban area. If you remember, when we talked about urban area, when we talked about the reservoir routing, I don't know if you remember this, reservoir routing, you should remember that if an incoming water discharge, or better, an incoming hydrograph is defined, and in this case this could be named as the design hydrograph, actually in the presence of a large water body, a lake just for example, the water discharge that flows out from the lake is something like this, in which the maximum water discharge is not qd, but it is equal to q star. So if q star can flow into the river within the urban area, it could be possible in general to deploy a kind of hydraulic structure here that is able to store a part of the water upstream the urban area in order to make possible to decrease the water discharge coming here equal to Q star. So the water discharge, the maximum water discharge, has decreased thanks to this water body. Also in this case, this one is a kind of spillway. But also we can define also another possibility. Here we have the urban area. So this is the urban area. And of course we need to decrease this one. We can have a kind of water body, not directly on the river, but on one side. So you can understand that if you are able to convey water, instead to convey water into this water body, we can fill this water body, and then at the end of the hydrograph, we can convey the water again to the river, or if you want, we can also convey the water downstream to the urban area. So we can have always the necessity of deviate, or if you want, to subtract a portion of the water discharge from the river. Also in this case, we have a kind of spillway. Again, spillway. So in this case, here we have the maximum water discharge, that is QD, the design water discharge, but actually here we have the design water discharge minus the water discharge that is conveyed into this water body. So as you can understand, we need to talk about spillway. So we need to understand how to design spillway. So we need to understand the configuration, so the shape of the spillway, and then we need to talk about the design criteria. And we will discover that some of the design criteria, we have talked about the design criteria of spillway in one of the first lessons of this course. So actually, spillway is a new name in this course, but the physics and then the design criteria needed to design the spillway has been already tackled during this course. And just switch to Italian a little bit. Quindi quello che dobbiamo fare oggi, che dobbiamo provare a fare oggi, è quello di partire dalla osservazione che, preso un canale esistente, in realtà questo canale esistente potrebbe essere idraulicamente insufficiente a far defluire la portata di progetto. E quindi, come ho scritto qui, che cosa vuol dire? Che la profondità, cioè l'ipotesi di moto uniforme con cui defluisce la portata di progetto, è più grande dell'altezza del canale. Questa è una cosa piuttosto banale. Quindi per risolvere il problema abbiamo solo due possibilità: o facciamo il canale più grande o abbassiamo la portata. Fare il canale più grande nella realtà è come dire, una progettazione di cui già abbiamo parlato la volta scorsa, perché la volta scorsa abbiamo parlato di come si progettano i canali, volete erodibili o non erodibili, però comunque abbiamo visto come si progettano i canali, quindi siamo perfettamente in grado di applicare i criteri di progettazione per i canali, per modificare, per sapere quanto modificare la sezione che non è idraulicamente sufficiente. Oggi invece vorrei parlarvi un po' più nel dettaglio di come invece sia possibile in linea generale anche diminuire la portata in arrivo. Sembra un po' strano perché da un punto di vista fisico abbiamo visto che la portata deriva dalla pioggia. Sicuramente non possiamo agire sulla pioggia, ma dovremmo agire direttamente sulla portata, che non è un compito facile. E quindi in linea generale, giusto per darvi un'idea di che cosa vuol dire far diminuire la portata, semplicemente preso un fiume in cui defluisce, o meglio, in cui l'analisi degli estremi ci suggerisce che la portata di progetto sia uguale ad un certo valore, e qui abbiamo ad esempio un centro urbano all'interno del quale passa questo canale, che non è sufficiente a far defluire questa portata, possiamo realizzare un altro canale che bypassa l'area da difendere, per cui è necessario far defluire, o meglio, come si dice in italiano, esitare, cioè deviare una porzione, una parte della portata di progetto da un'altra parte. Ora, se siamo addirittura vicino al mare, questa deviazione potrebbe non rientrare direttamente nel fiume principale, ma addirittura sfociare direttamente nel mare. Questo ad esempio viene chiamato tipicamente un canale scolmatore. In questo caso, quindi nel caso del canale scolmatore, che cosa dovremmo fare? Dovremmo sicuramente progettare il canale, ma questo lo sappiamo fare. In questo caso la portata sfiorata, la portata totale sfiorata è il parametro di progetto e quindi dobbiamo semplicemente progettare il canale. Dall'altra parte però abbiamo anche la necessità di progettare il dispositivo, l'opera idraulica in grado di deviare questa portata. E come si devia questa portata? Con uno sfioratore. Quindi con quello che qui abbiamo ripetuto più di una volta chiamarsi spillway. Quindi come vedete, in questo caso qui abbiamo uno spillway. E abbiamo un canale. Channel. Questo lo sappiamo dimensionare. Quindi questo lo sappiamo dimensionare, questo no. Poi andiamo avanti. Se sfocia direttamente al mare, stessa cosa. Questo lo sappiamo dimensionare, questo no. Se andiamo ancora avanti, se vi ricordate quando abbiamo fatto la propagazione delle onde di piena all'interno degli invasi, volete artificiali o naturali, ci siamo accorti che se c'è un lago, un corpo idrico, in realtà la portata diminuisce da questo valore ad un altro valore. E quindi è possibile in linea generale, realizzare un'opera, ovviamente idraulica, che crea un invaso in linea, diciamo così, direttamente sul fiume. In questo caso questo è un corpo idrico che abbassa la portata. Ma come faccio a creare questo corpo idrico? Di nuovo uno spillway. E quindi come si progetta questo spillway? Oppure potremmo addirittura deviare una portata non su un corpo idrico che è costituito direttamente sul fiume, ma immediatamente diciamo, al lato del fiume, come si dice in derivazione. Quindi l'idea è quella di far defluire una parte della portata in questa sorta di vasca, per cui quella che continua è sicuramente inferiore, e quando finisce l'evento, quest'acqua può essere restituita al fiume, o a monte dell'area da proteggere o addirittura anche a valle. Come faccio? Devo dimensionare uno sfioratore, che in questo caso però non è come nel caso precedente frontale. Come vedete qui l'acqua gli passa sopra, quindi vuol dire che è frontale, ma laterale, perché l'acqua invece deve defluire lateralmente. Quindi in linea generale avrete capito che abbiamo bisogno di capire innanzitutto che cosa sono gli sfioratori, che cos'è uno sfioratore, e poi dobbiamo capire come progettarlo. E ci accorgeremo che la progettazione di uno sfioratore in realtà è un argomento di cui abbiamo già parlato, Ne abbiamo parlato perché abbiamo dovuto parlare della fisica del deflusso in presenza di una serie di opere. Quindi, nella sostanza, vi sto dicendo che la parte più complicata, che è la parte della progettazione, in realtà, meno di qualche dettaglio di cui dobbiamo parlare oggi, in realtà ne abbiamo già parlato. Then now we need to understand which is the configuration of a spillway, but also how we can design them. So we need to start from this kind of case. So imagine this is the bottom of a river. So from here we have a water discharge that is flowing to the right of this blackboard. Of course, here we have the water level, okay? And this is a solid body. If I make kind of zoom here, we have this kind of situation. So we have this is more or less 45 degrees, and this is the standard configuration of the Bazzen spillway. So this is very thin, molto sottile. And then in this case, the water, of course, here will flow in this way. But the problem is here. Here we have a kind of this behavior of the so-called lower nap. And this is the upper nap. Upper nap. Now, in Italian nap is vena effluente, quindi questa è la parte inferiore della vena effluente, e questa qua è la parte superiore della vena effluente. Now, from a practical point of view, it is really difficult to deploy a thin wall with this configuration aimed to increase the water level upstream and able to influence the, we can say, the water profile both downstream and upstream. So this Bazzen spillway is usually possible only for very small structure. We cannot deploy a structure like this with several meters high, with a height of several meters, because we can have a series of structural issues. So if the structure, the channel is very small. Typically, the Bazzen spillway can be used in experimental investigations or just as measurement station in the reality. But usually, we cannot deploy a structure as this. But we must think to deploy a larger structure. So usually, the structure that we deploy is more or less this one. This one. So, as you can understand, as you can guess, the Bazzen spillway is more or less the upstream part of this spillway. And this one is very similar to the lower nap. Lower NAP. Now, just to show you an example, here you can see that actually we have the lower NAP, that first comes upwards and then falls downstream in this case. So here we have a kind of upstream water depth that we can call H0, and this is a kind of horizontal line. Starting from a certain distance, say it X, the profile, the water depth changes, and then the flux occurs over the spillway. So this is an experimental observation about the lower NAP, Now, the idea is that this structure can be deployed only when the reality is has very small size. So just for example, if I need to measure the water discharge in small river, in small flume, I can deploy a basin spillway. But usually we need of high inertia structure. So we cannot, due to structural issues, deploy this kind of structure. And then we need to switch to this one. So actually, this is concrete, usually. So this is a very heavy structure. So this is usually concrete. And the idea is to design, to draw the configuration of the spillway in such a way the shape is very similar to the lower NAP. So we need to understand which is the shape of the lower NAP. So some researchers in the past studied the shape of the lower NAP. This is more or less the idea. So I repeat, the idea is to design the spillway in a way in which the shape is very similar to the lower NAP flowing over a basin, a thin spillway, in the thin spillway case. So we need to use this line. So we need to know this line. If we can switch here, If we again depict a basin, we can have this one. Some researcher, if we define a kind of this reference frame, these researchers gave us the shape of the function, the formal function that express the lower NAP location, so this is the lower NAP, as a function of the distance from the highest point of the NAP. So actually we don't know this part, but starting from the upper part we are able to draw the shape of the lower NAP. Actually, this H is equal, more or less, to a kind of this simple relationship, more from a formal point of view. And this parameter A and this parameter N depends on a series of parameter. Just for example, this is this is the eight of the of the spillway, but also we need to know the hydraulic head occurring just upstream the spillway. So in general, in very general, this relationship is, from a formal point of view, able to describe this part of the lower neck, and then we can use this relationship, or a relationship almost similar to this one, in order to draw the shape of the configuration. We have to observe that the shape, of course, depends on the hydraulic head upstream the spillway. So if the upstream hydraulic head changes, also, of course, the lower neck changes. Just to understand, if I have the Bazen spillway with a level of the water upstream, I will have this lower neck. Oh, sorry, this lower neck. If in general I have a higher hydraulic head upstream, of course, I will have something like this. And if I have a lower hydraulic head, of course, we will have a different lower neck of the flow. Now, the problem is, we have no problem when we talk about this kind of structure. But if we fill with concrete, this part, of course, the lower neck cannot change because we have concrete. So, as you can understand, we need to define an hydraulic head, a design hydraulic head. Indeed, in this case here, H0, that is the hydraulic head occurring from a physical point of view, should be substituted by the design hydraulic head. So we need to select a value of the hydraulic head in order to design the spillway, and then we have to answer to the question, but what happens when the upstream hydraulic head is higher or lower than the design hydraulic head? I switch to Italian. Quindi avete capito che l'idea è quella di realizzare uno sfioratore con una forma la cui parte superiore assomiglia alla forma della vena effluente da uno stramazzo Bazen. Qual è il problema? È che ovviamente, anche se qualcuno si è messo a studiare questo fenomeno fisico, ovviamente la forma della vena effluente inferiore dipende dal carico idraulico di monte. Ora, se noi ci mettiamo del calcestruzzo qui dentro, la vena non cambia. Cioè, non è che l'acqua può entrare nel calcestruzzo, si può staccare dal calcestruzzo. La vena effluente, nel momento in cui riempiamo di calcestruzzo questa parte, non cambia, almeno nella parte inferiore. Quindi, quello che gli scienziati, diciamo così, i ricercatori, si sono chiesti in relazione all'analisi del fenomeno fisico, cioè la domanda era, fissato un carico a monte, qual è la forma della vena effluente inferiore? Ora noi dobbiamo declinare questa affermazione non da un punto di vista, diciamo così, scientifico, fisico, ma da un punto di vista tecnico. Siccome noi dobbiamo riempire il calcestruzzo una porzione del mondo, ci dobbiamo chiedere qual è il carico, non quello effettivo, ma quello con cui dobbiamo disegnare lo sfioratore. Quindi quel carico passa dall'essere identificato con un H0, H0 è una sorta di carico idraulico che si verifica a monte dello stramazzo. Questo è il concetto. Dobbiamo passare da questo concetto, che è un concetto che tipicamente è fisico, ad un concetto che deve essere invece di ingegneria. L'ingegneria non si chiede cosa succede in natura, si chiede che cosa succede in natura se realizziamo un'opera. Una cosa, se volete, sembra poco diversa, ma è molto diversa. Quindi quel carico non è più il carico che si verifica a monte dello stramazzo, ma è il carico con cui progetto l'opera. Quindi, andando avanti in questo schema, è ovvio che dal punto di vista fisico, se cambia il carico di monte, cambia la vena effluente inferiore da uno stramazzo Bazzen. Ma siccome noi stiamo riempendo di calcestruzzo questa parte, non è vero che cambia, e quindi abbiamo bisogno di cambiare il concetto dal carico che effettivamente si verifica a monte al carico con cui progettiamo lo sfidatore. Poi dovremmo chiederci: ma che cosa succede se il carico che effettivamente si verifica a monte è più grande e più piccolo del carico con cui abbiamo progettato l'opera? A questa domanda dobbiamo rispondere. E quindi rientriamo nella fisica, che ha però degli svolti sulla tecnica, cioè sull'ingegneria. So now we need to understand, for given hydraulic design, which is the shape of the spillway. And for the shape of the spillway, which is the water discharge that flows over the spillway, over the OG, as a function of the hydraulic head occurring upstream. Pay attention, the hydraulic head, the design hydraulic head, is different from the actual hydraulic head. It is not different only from a quantitative point of view. Not only the values can be different, but the concept is very different. The design hydraulic head is used to design the spillway and to get the values of the water discharge for varying hydraulic head. The H0, I mean the hydraulic head actually occurring upstream, is the reality. We need to understand what happens if H0 is higher or lower of the design hydraulic head. So we need to answer, first of all, to this to this question, and then we need to understand how we can estimate the water discharge as a function of the actual hydraulic head, not of the design hydraulic head. So we need to start from by talking about the shape of the spillway, then we need to switch to estimate the water discharge as a function of the hydraulic head occurring upstream, and we will discover that we will need to talk also about the pressure acting directly on the spillway. So this is a surprise, if you want. We are not interested in general to the pressure in this case, but we will discover that the pressure is a crucial point in the design of the spillways. So we need to start, first of all, for this aspect, and then to this second aspect that hide discussion about the pressure acting on the spillway. Now, switching again to the presentation, we can say in general again that here we have the 8 up to the upper part, the 8 of the spillway. Here we have a kind of 8 of the water here, with respect to the highest point of the spillway, and also we have the hydraulic head. As you can realize, here we can have the kinetic head. Indeed, the hydraulic head is a little bit higher than the location of the free surface. In general, in some applications, the kinetic head could be very small, so the design hydraulic head is more or less equal to the distance of the free surface from the highest point of the spillway. As you can realize from this one, this is a formulation proposed by the USBR, that is an old research institution that worked a lot on this topic, and that proposed a formulation like this, in which y is this this coordinate, so this is more or less this one, this is y. This is the design hydraulic head, and this one and this one are parameters. Again, x is this coordinate, and again we have the hydraulic head. So this one can be written in this way. Pay attention that this is true starting from this point. Then we have also the problem of the upstream part. And here, the USBR proposed to draw the upstream part as a compound curvilinear part. The first part has a radius equal to R1, and the second compound part has a lower radius equal to R2. And these R1 and R2, of course, the extension of the upper part, both in the horizontal direction and in the vertical direction, are given by means of empirical formulation. Indeed, just for example, if this part is vertical, the USBR propose a three-part, we can say this one. So we have a first one, a first part with radius R1, and R1 is equal to a half of the hydraulic head. Again, the hydraulic head is very important. Then we have the second radius, this one, starting from x1 to x2. And R2 is equal to the 20% of the hydraulic head again. And x1 is 0.175, again the hydraulic head. The same we can say about R3. XC, YC, and so on. But also the shape of the spillway is related to this parameter and this parameter. And this parameter are two numbers, the first one being equal to 2, the second one equal to 1.85. But also we can have a similar formulation, but in the case of subvertical upper part of the spillway. So if this part is not vertical, of course it is very steep, but it is not vertical, K and N is a little bit different, and the upper part has two The first one, Al 1, is about 70% of the hydraulic head, and Al 2 is about 20% of the hydraulic head, and of course we have XC, that is equal 0.257 the hydraulic head. As you can realize, we need to give the value of the hydraulic head, the design hydraulic head. So we need to start by keeping a value of the design hydraulic head, and then we can design the spillway. So a problem, one of the problems, is related to the definition of the hydraulic head, the design hydraulic head. I mean the hydraulic head that we need to use in order to design, to define the configuration of the spillway. Actually, the upstream part, this one, can be, has been proposed also as a part of the ellipse. So this one. So this is the equation of the ellipse. A and B are this one. A and B. So, from an empirical point of view, as a function of the height of the spillway. So we have, remember, always this situation. This is the height of the spillway, so P. The height of the spillway, normalized again with the hydraulic, the design hydraulic head, is a, so we can have the value of the horizontal axis, the value of the P, of the vertical. This is the horizontal, this is the horizontal, this is the vertical, but also the value of the parameter K as a function of the height of the spillway. Of course, all these parameters are normalized against the design hydraulic head. Again, in order to design the upper part of the spillway, we need to define the hydraulic head. So just as you can understand, if the height of the spillway is very large, if compared to the hydraulic head, these numbers are constant. So here we have again at least 0.28. Here we have something like a little bit more than 0.16. And here we have a number equal to almost 2. Indeed, if we come back to the first previous slide, we have these two. So as you can understand, this is proposed by another research institute that is called the WES. But the physics, the meaning of the factors of the parameters are almost the same. Now, just as an example, we can give a value of the height of the spillway and a value of the design hydraulic head. The problem is to draw the spillway, but it is not so complex. Indeed, we can have from in the case of vertical upstream part, we can compute also all these parameters. So XC is this one, and it is equal to about 1 meter. Then we have this one, it is about a half a meter. Then we have R1, the curvature of the first part, and it is almost equal to 1.7 meters. The second one and the third one. I mean the curvature radius of this, the upstream part. But also we can define also this one, 60 centimeters and about 1 meter. And finally, of course, we have K and N equal to 2 and 1.85 respectively. If the upstream part of the spillway is not vertical, we can repeat the computation, and here we have XC, that is the total the total extension of the upstream part, equal to about 90 centimeters, and the other hydraulic the other curvature radius here equal to 2.4 meters and 0.7 meters. But also we can apply the WES criteria. So here we have for the upper part the horizontal and vertical axis of the ellipse that forms the upstream part of the spillway. Then in this case we can have the this one and this one. So we have here B and A. And by using a standard CAD program on what you want, you can draw the shape. Of course, here we have a problem. Indeed, if you think that here we have also an horizontal part, here we need to make a kind of transition. Of course, but we can draw this one, that is Y, as you can realize from this one, this relationship. So Y is equal to X power N over K H design N minus 1. So this relationship must be used to design, to draw the configuration of the spillway, just for example, as for the USBR. Then, very basically, the shape of the spillway is not so difficult to understand, but we have the more important thing that in the upstream part, we have an increasing shape up to the highest point, and then up to this point, we have another decreasing point. Actually, there is also another shape that it is not used a lot, but if we have we depict a Bazen spillway, we write the shape of the lower nap. I depict in red the shape of the spillway. So the spillway is actually this one. Again, we have an upstream part that increases its elevation, and then a downstream part that decreases its elevation, but also we have this particular shape upstream, and this is called the Shimemi profile. Shimemi is a famous Italian hydraulic engineer a long time ago, and this shape actually has been used in all around the world a long time ago, before the USBR and WES formulation was proposed. Then, basically, a spillway is characterized by an upstream wall that can be vertical or almost vertical, we can say sub-vertical, so very steep, even if not exactly vertical, and a first part in which the elevation of the spillway increases, and then a downstream part that decreases, in which the elevation decreases. Of course, we need of a kind of transition in order to merge the upstream profile to the downstream sub-horizontal profile at the bottom downstream. Usually this one is related to a curvature radius that very basically is something like that. So we have this one, we have this one, we have this one, and then we have the transition with a hydraulic with a curvature radius that is given by formulation, empirical formulation, like those that we have seen up to now. Now we need to understand how change the water discharge as a function of the actual hydraulic head occurring upstream. And the formulation is not new. We have seen this formulation in the past. So we have that the water discharge flowing over a spillway is equal to a parameter mu, this is a parameter, times the wetted area upstream the spillway times the square root of 2 times g, the acceleration of gravity, times the water depth with respect to the upper part of the spillway upstream. So what I'm saying that if this is the spillway, we have the water that is something like that. We have to measure this H0. H0 is not influenced by the presence of the spillway. Did this decrease in water depth of the free surface elevation is related to the presence of the spillway. Actually, here this value is not influenced by the velocity of the flow, but only, of course, by the presence of the spillway, because anyway, otherwise we have not an increase of the water depth, but out of the outlet, if I can say. So we have a parameter, the longitudinal extension, so this is L, and 2 times the gravitational acceleration H0 power 3. The really secret of spillways is the value of mu. Mu is the parameter that is the secret of spillway, and we will understand why. In general, we can have different shape of the spillway. Indeed, we can have the Bélanger spillway. Bélanger spillway is roughly, okay, this one, Eraser. Ok. If we have an horizontal spillway, here we have the upstream H0. Of course, in this case, we have something like that. In this case, here we have the critical depth, because here we have a subcritical flow. Here we have a supercritical flow. Somewhere the critical water depth will occur. Then we can use the conservation of the energy. The energy is conserved because the velocity is increasing, and usually when the velocity increases, the energy is more or less conserved. And by using this relationship, so the energy, so we have E0 is equal to EC. So this is the C section where the critical state occurs, and here we have the zero section. So the energy, specific energy at this section is equal to the specific energy here. And then we have this one. So the relationship, if this one is neglected, we have the relationship of the water discharge as a function of H0, but also we have the critical water depth. Of course, if we take into account a longitudinal extension equal to L, the wetted area is equal to LYC, of course. Now, for rectangular section, the critical water depth is equal to 2 over 3, the critical energy. Then we can, but as the critical energy is equal to the E0, and E0 is equal to H0, this is almost equal to this one. So we can put this result into this formulation, and we get this relationship. If we perform a little bit of algebra, we find this one. So we have 2 over 3 square root L square root of 2GH0 power 3. If you look at this term, is the same of this one. Here we have L, here we have L. So 2 over 3, the square root of 3, is exactly equal to mo. So for a large spillway, so a spillway, sorry, a spillway that has this particular shape, the value of mu is equal to 0.385. So you can understand that mu is influenced by the shape. Is influenced by the shape. Indeed, in the case of Bazen spillway, we have mu equal to 0.407 plus a small correction related to the ratio of the hydraulic head upstream the spillway and the height of the spillway. If we use the shape that we have described so far, so in this case we have this one, in this case we have this one, the parameter mu is equal to 0.495. So we have in this case mu is equal 0.385, as you can remember from here. Here in this case, We have 0.0 plus a small value. In this case, we have 0.495. What it means? That if I have the same hydraulic head upstream to this one, here we have a water discharge of mu L 2GH0 power 3. The water discharge flowing from over this spillway is lower than the water discharge flowing over this shape. So the efficiency increases. So the shape of the spillway influences the water discharge by means of this parameter. So this parameter is very important. Now we need to understand why this spillway, this shape is more efficient in the water discharge flows. We need to understand why this parameter is higher than this one. Indeed, if you remember, this shape is more or less this shape. So it is not so clear why this parameter and this parameter are so different and why this spillway is more efficient in conveying water discharge. Indeed, we need to talk about pressure. This is the secret. The secret of this spillway is related to the pressure. So we need to understand why this shape influences the pressure and how this pressure makes more efficient the spillway in conveying water discharge. But we will talk about this topic after the stop. So we have understood a very important aspect, and the aspect is related to the value of this coefficient, and this coefficient is basically describes the efficiency of the spillway in conveying the water discharge. So we realized that the shape of the spillway is very important. A rough spillway, just as this one, is not really efficient. Indeed, this parameter has a low value if compared to the Bazin case, or at least to the shape that we are talking about in this case. Now we need to understand why this shape is more efficient than this shape, and in order to understand this we need to talk about, at least from a qualitative point of view, about what happens when the hydraulic head upstream the spillway is different from the design hydraulic head. So we need to talk about the design hydraulic head compared to the actual hydraulic head. So we need to, first of all, to depict the spillway. And then we try to understand what happens when the hydraulic head upstream the spillway is almost similar to the design hydraulic head. Of course, we have a situation like this one. This is, let's try to, I try to depict Here we have the upper free surface location, and the lower one is this one, okay? Now, if we remove the spillway by keeping the shape of the bazen spillway, we can imagine that the shape of the lower nap does not change. This is the crucial aspect. The lower part of the flow is the same with or without the spillway with this given shape. Now, if a spillway, a bazen spillway is considered, the pressure here is more or less equal to the atmospheric pressure. Quindi la parte cruciale che giustifica anche il perché realizzare uno sfioratore con la forma della vena effluente inferiore, perché nel caso di una pressione, nel caso di uno stramazzo bazen, la pressione in corrispondenza della vena effluente inferiore è uguale a zero, ovviamente. C'è la pressione atmosferica sopra, la pressione atmosferica sotto, nel getto, siccome la velocità è piuttosto costante, se vi ricordate dall'idraulica, la pressione è costante e quindi è uguale a quella atmosferica. So, when the hydraulic head is equal to the design hydraulic head, so I mean, actually here I should to write H, sorry, with white, H0 almost equal to the hydraulic head, the pressure acting on the concrete surface is almost equal to the atmospheric pressure. This is a crucial aspect. Now, if the, we switch to another color, the green one, if the actual hydraulic head H0 is lower than H than the design hydraulic head, with bazen, of course, we have this one. Of course, this elevation is lower than this one, but the lower part is the same. If a bazen spillway is considered, actually this one should be this. So the lower nap will decrease its distance from the spillway. But as here we have concrete, the lower nap cannot decrease the distance from the spillway. Then, in this case, here, we have a pressure higher than zero. So, if the actual hydraulic head is lower than the design hydraulic head, the pressure acting on the spillway is higher if compared to the pressure acting on the spillway when the actual hydraulic head is equal, almost equal to design hydraulic head. So we can define here H, the actual hydraulic head, and here the pressure acting on the spillway. We can have H0 lower than the design hydraulic head, PS, so the pressure acting on the spillway, is positive. So the pressure, the relative pressure, is positive. I mean, the pressure is higher than the atmospheric pressure. If the actual hydraulic head is similar to the design hydraulic head, the pressure acting on the spillway is almost equal to zero. I mean, the pressure is almost equal to the atmospheric pressure. But now we need to switch to the more important case, the case in which H0 is higher than the design hydraulic head. In this case, of course, we have this one. Of course, here we have that the water profile follows the spillway shape, but in the case of Bazen spillway, the lower neck should be this one. So the lower neck wants to leave the spillway surface, but it cannot, as you have this water in the upper part. So of course it is difficult to have that the lower neck detaches from the spillway. But in this case, with a yellow line, we can guess that the pressure is lower than zero. So when the actual hydraulic head is higher than the design hydraulic head, the pressure is negative. Of course, the relative pressure is negative. I mean that if the water the hydraulic head occurring upstream the spillway is higher than the design hydraulic head, the pressure is lower than zero. So here we have a kind, actually here we have a kind of depression. So, in a clear way, if this is the spillway, if here we have an hydraulic head higher than the design hydraulic head, we have an area in which the pressure is lower than zero. You know, by remembering the Eulero equation, the equation of motion, the equation, the momentum equation, you know that the acceleration of the velocity is proportional to the gradient of the pressure. This is almost clear also from an intuitive point of view. If you have a lower pressure here, the flow is promoted here. So this pressure is the motivation for which this shape is very effective in conveying water discharge. So the shape and the selection of the design hydraulic head allows to affirm that in this case H0 power 3, in this case mu is higher than other shape, and this is related to the pressure. I switch to Italian. Capisco che questo diciamo grafico non sia così chiaro adesso che lo vediamo finito, però il concetto è sintetizzato in quella tabella che vedete a destra in alto. Cioè, fissato il carico di progetto con cui disegniamo lo sfioratore e confrontando il carico che effettivamente si può verificare a monte, osserviamo che se il carico effettivo è più o meno uguale al carico di progetto, la pressione è uguale a zero. La pressione è uguale a zero perché in un flusso, in un getto, la pressione all'interno del getto è quella atmosferica e quindi è quella atmosferica anche sulla vena inferiore. Questo vuol dire che se noi disegniamo lo sfioratore con una forma molto simile a quella che avremmo in assenza dello sfioratore, ma in presenza di uno sfioratore Bazen, di uno stramazzo Bazen, allora la pressione sarebbe atmosferica e in effetti anche osservazioni sperimentali dimostrano che sullo sfioratore, quando il carico è uguale a quello con cui è stato disegnato lo sfioratore, la pressione è uguale a zero. Ma se noi abbassiamo il carico a monte, mantenendo il disegno dello sfioratore, capite che la vena vorrebbe avvicinarsi allo stramazzo, ma non può. Quindi che cosa fa? Non fa nient'altro che appoggiarsi sullo sfioratore, il che vuol dire che la pressione è più grande rispetto a quella atmosferica. Infine, se invece il carico è più alto rispetto a quello di progetto, la vena vorrebbe distaccarsi dallo sfioratore. Questo non succede, perché ovviamente c'è l'acqua che insiste al di sopra, per cui non permette il distaccamento. Ma quello che succede è che la pressione è negativa. È una cosa che dal punto di vista intuitivo non è semplice. Cioè è difficile immaginare che nel deflusso a superficie libera ci siano delle zone in cui la pressione è negativa. In realtà, in corrispondenza dello sfioratore, si crea un'area a bassa pressione. Vedete lì quelle linee tratteggiate? Immaginatevi come un'area in cui la pressione è più piccola. Ma se lì la pressione è più piccola, è come se voi aveste una sorta di impianto di sollevamento, una pompa che succhia acqua e quindi migliora la capacità di deflusso di questo stramazzo, di questa forma di sfioratore. Quindi, per semplice forma, questo tipo di sfioratore è molto efficace nel far defluire la portata. E questo è un po' il segreto. Quindi, come vedete, il segreto è legato alla pressione. Now we have a problem, because we are happy that the pressure is lower than zero. Indeed, if the pressure, the relative pressure, is lower than zero, is negative, then the spillway is effective in conveying water. But if the pressure is too low, if P is too low, then we can have a strange phenomenon that is called cavitation. Cavitation. What I mean, very basically, the cavitation is a phenomenon related to the fact that if the pressure is too low, the water changes its state to the vapor, to a gas. Then this gas, this droplet of gas within the water, is convected downstream when the pressure increases. Then this gas changes again its state into water with a great change of volume. So the cavitation is related to large change of volume. Not only large change of volume, but also suddenly. I mean, the volume of the gas changes is very large and occurs in a very short time duration. So it is like a bomb. Then the water explodes, and then it can damages the concrete. So usually, if the actual hydraulic head is higher than the design hydraulic head and it is too high, the pressure here can be lower than a safe limit of the pressure and the concrete may be damaged by the cavitation phenomenon. This is an important thing, then I need to switch to Italian. Quindi, parlando di questa pressione, in realtà il fatto che la pressione sia negativa è un fatto molto positivo, perché è come se ci fosse un fenomeno naturale per cui l'acqua viene succhiata da questo sfioratore. Il problema qual è? Che se la pressione è troppo bassa, se la pressione diventa troppo bassa, l'acqua non ha più motivo di esistere e si trasforma in vapore. Cioè c'è un cambiamento di stato, come l'acqua che bolle. Perché l'acqua bolle? Perché voi aumentate la temperatura e quindi l'acqua si trasforma in aria, o meglio in vapore acqueo. In questo caso l'acqua comincia a bollire, ma non perché sta aumentando la temperatura, ma perché sta diminuendo la pressione. Qui dovremmo ricorrere al diagramma di stato dell'acqua. Sapete che il cambiamento di stato si ha sia perché aumenta la temperatura, sia perché diminuisce la pressione. In questo caso l'acqua bolle perché diminuisce la pressione. Quindi cosa succede? Che dove si verifica questa pressione, l'acqua diventa vapore. Quindi si creano queste microbollicine di vapore che vengono trasportate dalla corrente, ovviamente. Non è che rimangono ferme lì. Voi immaginatevi che qui l'acqua sta defluendo anche con velocità molto elevata. Quindi in realtà queste bollicine, sono delle bollicine, vengono trasportate verso valle, dove la pressione ovviamente tende ad aumentare. Non è che la pressione è minore di zero per tutta la vita, o meglio, per tutta l'area che sta a valle dello sfioratore. Quindi che cosa succede? Queste bollicine che si creano in corrispondenza del calcestruzzo che costituisce lo sfioratore si formano in una certa area, e tipicamente quest'area è questa, cioè nella zona in cui la pressione è più piccola, vengono trasportate verso valle ed essendo trasportate verso valle la pressione aumenta e vogliono tornare acqua. Quindi questo abbiamo una trasformazione di fase da liquido a vapore e da vapore a liquido. Queste trasformazioni sono molto repentine, sono molto veloci e sono accompagnate da grandi cambiamenti di volume. E da un punto di vista fisico, grandi cambiamenti di volume in tempi molto brevi sono la definizione di esplosioni. Quindi immaginatevi come se l'acqua agisse come una serie di granate che vengono buttate sul calcestruzzo e quindi le opere vengono a volte solo danneggiate, a volte distrutte dal fenomeno della cavitazione. Quindi il problema della pressione troppo bassa è un problema molto importante. Then, as the cavitation phenomenon can damage the structure, the spillway, it is very important to check that the actual hydraulic head is not so higher than the design hydraulic head. So from a technical point of view, we need to define the design hydraulic head. We have to identify the H max, I mean the actual hydraulic head for which P at the spillway is equal to a minimum mi limit of the pressure. And then we need to check that H0 is here. So here we have an elevation. Here we have an elevation. We need to check that H0 is lower than H max from a technical point of view. Of course, if HD decreases for given H0, when H0 occurs, the spillway is very effective. So we want that the effective hydraulic head is higher than the design hydraulic head. But we must verify that the actual maximum hydraulic head is lower than the maximum allowable hydraulic head. So, from an engineering point of view, HD should be low enough in order to have H0 lower than Hmax. In this case, when a flood occurs, the hydraulic head is higher than the design hydraulic head, but the hydraulic head is lower than the maximum allowable hydraulic head. Usually, this minimum pressure is identified in 7.6 meter of water column. I mean, P min over specific weight of water is equal to minus 7.6 meters. So this is the limit. This limit was identified by means of observation in the field and also by means of experimental investigation, always from WESS, so the same research institute that we talked about before. But if we have the minimum pressure acting on the minimum allowable pressure acting on the speedway, we need of some formulation for the pressure actually acting on the speedway. And usually we can say that the pressure acting on the spillway is more or less equal to a parameter K times the effective hydraulic head times 1 minus K, where K is the ratio between H0 and the design hydraulic head. So, as you can understand, PS is equal to K H0 1 minus H0 HD. When H0 is equal to HD, this is 1, then this is 0, then the pressure acting on the spillway is 0. If H0 is lower than the design hydraulic head, the pressure is positive. When H0 is higher than the design hydraulic head, the pressure is negative. Indeed, if we make a plot with the spilling, the pressure acting on the spillway, and here we have K, so here we have 1, and the K, remember, is H0 over HD, we have a behavior more or less like this one. Oh, sorry, like this one. So, for H0, if HD is higher than H0, so we can write here we can write that if K is higher than 1, H0 is higher than, sorry. H0 is, oh, actually, this is not the case. H0 is higher than the design because the behavior is this one. So, in this, if K is higher than 1, H0 is higher than the design hydraulic head, and the pressure acting on the spillway is lower than 0. If the hydraulic head is equal to the The design hydraulic head, the pressure is zero. If H0 is lower than the design hydraulic head, the pressure is higher than zero. Then, somewhere here, we have the minimum allowable pressure. Then it means that this is the maximum Kmax. Okay? So what we are saying that if we know this curve, we can select HD in order to have the maximum probable hydraulic head occurring during the design water discharge, okay, equal to Kmax. So if we come back here, we have this problem, K, but K can be written as almost equal to 1. So what we can write? We can write that P over the spillway is equal to K, that is equal to 1, H0, 1 minus K. I can equal to this one to P min. Ok? P min. So from here we can write H0 over HD 1 minus chi is equal to P min over HD. If the pressure is equal to P min, of course chi is equal to chi max, and this is H0 max. This is chi. So we have chi max 1 minus chi max is equal to P min over HD. So as you can understand, this is chi max minus chi max squared, chi max times 1, chi max times chi max, minus P min over HD is equal to 0. From this one we can have chi max. Then that is equal to H0 max over HD. So we can use, so from this relationship we have a number. This is a number. Just for example, 2 is a number. This relationship can be used to define HD as a function of H0 max, or we can check that for given HD, H0 max is lower than the highest expected. What I mean? That we of course start from TR. We know the Qmax or the hydrograph. Then we can compute with some method the maximum max, H0 max. Then, as we know Qmax, that is a value is equal to H0 max over HD. So I mean we can define the design hydraulic head as H0 max that we have computed here over Kmax that is a value. What is the problem? That this one depends on the shape of the spillway, and if this one depends on the shape of the spillway, it depends, is influenced by the design hydraulic head. So we need to start start from a guess value of the design hydraulic head. We compute H0 max. Then we compute the, we verify that H0 max, so we have to verify that H0 max equal to key max times HD. We need to compute this and we have to compare to the actual is higher, the actual expected maximum, sorry, this is higher, this must be higher than the maximum expected value of the hydraulic head. So as you can understand, the problem is not so simple. Indeed, this value comes from, just for example, the flooding propagation due to the presence of a spillway. And in this way, we have understood that if the pressure decreases, the this coefficient, where is the coefficient? Here. The coefficient of the spillway. Okay, I don't. I'm here. If the pressure decreases, the mu increases. Indeed, we have said that 2GH0 power 3, mu is related to the efficiency of the spillway. And we have understood that if PS is low, the efficiency of the spillway is higher. Then the lower the pressure on the spillway, the higher the value of mu, then the more effective is the spillway. Indeed, as a function of the key, remember key is equal to H0 over HD, we can have this one. Here we have 0.595, but for increasing key, I mean for decreasing pressure, where is the pressure? Here, for decreasing pressure, the value of mu increases too. Indeed, mu can be written as mu 0 or 1 plus key over plus key, something like that. Indeed, here we can have this one. So in reality, this relationship is not correct. We know that this one, the actual relationship is this one. So as you can understand, when key is equal to 1, the value of mu is a little bit lower than 0.5. It is equal to 0.495. If key is higher than 1, the value of key is higher than this value. I mean, in this case, the spillway is more effective from an hydraulic point of view. And we can evaluate the value of mu by means of this one. But we have to pay attention to the maximum allowable value of key, because the maximum allowable value of key is related to P-min. Actually, here the design hydraulic head is missing. Just to make an example, if we have an hydraulic a design hydraulic head equal to 3.5 meters, we have this one, we can solve this one, then we have the maximum allowable value of the ratio. Remember again that this one is the definition of key. The maximum allowable value of key is about 2. So I mean the maximum allowable H0, I mean the maximum allowable value of the effective hydraulic head is about twice the hydraulic, the design hydraulic head. So if I design the spillway with 3.5 meters, actually this is the maximum allowable hydraulic head. So I mean I designed the spillway with this hydraulic head. This is 3.5. But I can use the spillway also for higher hydraulic head. So if this is my QD, the design water discharge, I know that this is related to an hydraulic head lower than the maximum allowable, and I know that during the design event the spillway is very effective in conveying water. So it is a trade-off. The design hydraulic head must be low enough in order to have an effective spillway, but the hydraulic head cannot be too low, otherwise the effective hydraulic head is higher than the maximum allowable. I mean that up to this point cavitation is likely to occur. I switch to Italian.
Quindi, come vedete, è un gioco, se volete, anche piuttosto complicato, perché io sto osando, cioè io non progetto lo sfioratore con il massimo carico che mi aspetto, perché se lo progetto con un carico inferiore, quello che succede è che quando avviene la portata di progetto, lo sfioratore è al meglio delle sue possibilità, perché sta funzionando benissimo, perché c'è una pressione piccola, c'è una pressione negativa, va in depressione. Quindi quando arriva l'evento di progetto, lo sfioratore è molto efficiente nel far defluire dell'acqua. Capite? Quindi io sono interessato a tenere il carico di progetto più basso di quello che effettivamente si verificherà nel futuro. Ma dall'altra parte non può essere troppo basso, perché altrimenti quello che succede è che quando avviene il carico di progetto, il carico è così più alto del carico di progetto che possa andare incontro alla cavitazione. E la cavitazione è un qualcosa assolutamente da scongiurare, perché l'opera si rompe. Cioè è una questione legata proprio alla sopravvivenza di questo tipo di opere. Just to understand how we can use this information, perhaps you remember when we talked about the reservoir routing. If you remember, we used the continuity equation, so the variation of the volume along the time is equal to the difference of the inlet water discharge minus the outlet water discharge. By writing this equation within the frame of finite difference framework, we obtained this difference equation that we solved if you remember, by means of the Runge-Kutta method or other method. But
Here we have the stage storage calve. Here we have the calve related to the spillway. Indeed, this one is equal to Q equal to mu L 2 G H 0 power 3. Then we used this relationship. Of course, this is true starting from the elevation, this one, the elevation of the upper part of the spillway. Now, when we talked about the reservoir routing, we used a number for mu. Now, mu is a function of H0, but H0 is a function of the solution, this one. So I mean the elevation within the lake. So you can guess that we should repeat the computation by taking into account also mu, ma mu is a function of course of H0, but also of HD. I mean the design hydraulic head. Indeed, as you can understand, this is related, this is the maximum elevation within the lake if this incoming water discharge occurs and this outlet water discharge is related to the incoming one, then this one is zeta max. I mean, we have somewhere the spillway. Here we have the elevation of the water discharge. This is H0. So if we take the elevation 149.6, this is H0 max. This H0 max comes from the numerical resolution of this equation. So, zeta max comes from the resolution of this one. This one minus the elevation of the spillway, this is zeta s, then this is zeta s, then this is H0 max. H0 max must be lower than H max. In this case, must be lower than 7.20. As you can realize, this is lower than 7.20. But we need to verify that this is true. And this is true because we have selected HD. Indeed, from here, this one is known only if the design hydraulic head is known. Indeed, we have this relationship. Indeed, here we have key, and key is equal to H0, then key is known also only if we know the design hydraulic head. So what I mean is that this can be computed only if we know the design hydraulic head. If the design hydraulic head is known, we can compute the outlet water discharge, but also we can compute the evolution of the free surface elevation. And if the free surface elevation is known, we can compute H0. Indeed, just coming here, within the example, we have zeta w as a function of the time, and this is the solution of reservoir routing. But
H0, I mean the actual hydraulic head occurring upstream the speedway, is equal to zeta w minus the elevation of the speedway. Then, if I have this plot of zeta w, I can obtain also H0 plot. This is the time, this is zero, of course, I have this one, and I have this one. So this one is H0 max, and this must be lower than the maximum allowable hydraulic head. So as you can understand, the design of speedway is related, as in this example, also to the pressure acting on the concrete of the speedway. Then the pressure is part of the criteria to design the speedway. Quindi, tornando a... I switch to Italian. Tornando al problema del dimensionamento di un'opera di sfioro, ad esempio nel caso in cui si ha presidio di un lago, e quindi per diminuire per laminare le portate, come si dice, potete osservare che l'altra volta, partendo dall'equazione di continuità, siamo passati all'equazione delle differenze, e dall'equazione delle differenze, utilizzando queste funzioni, abbiamo ottenuto l'idrogramma laminato, che è questa linea rossa, diciamo così, ma abbiamo ottenuto anche l'andamento della posizione dell'elevazione della superficie libera all'interno del lago, che quindi sostanzialmente è legato al carico che insiste sullo sfioratore stesso, senza tener conto del fatto, l'altra volta non abbiamo tenuto conto del fatto che in realtà il coefficiente di efflusso dello sfioratore cambia al variare, è una funzione della quota dell'acqua della superficie libera nel lago. L'altra volta abbiamo trascurato la variazione del coefficiente di efflusso dalla quota della superficie libera all'interno del lago. Ora siamo in grado di tener conto anche di questo aspetto, perché sappiamo come e perché questo coefficiente di efflusso cambia. Perché? Perché diminuisce la pressione, se il carico che effettivamente si verifica è più grande del carico di progetto. Ma dall'altro sappiamo anche di quanto cambia, perché abbiamo questa formula che vedete qui. Quindi adesso siamo in grado di progettare uno sfioratore che sia a servizio di un invaso artificiale in tutti i suoi dettagli. E la cosa più importante è che progettiamo un'opera, uno sfioratore che non si rompa durante l'evento di progetto. Perché non si deve rompere? Perché la pressione deve essere superiore al valore minimo possibile, perché altrimenti si va in cavitazione. Se si va in cavitazione, l'opera si rompe. Now, as a synthesis, we can say we have understood that here we can have a pressure lower than zero, but this negative pressure is a good phenomenon. Indeed, if the pressure is negative, the spillway is more effective in conveying water discharge. So we want a negative pressure, but we must verify that this negative pressure is not too low. Indeed, we have to check that this pressure is higher than a minimum value. Now, from a physical point of view, this pressure, or better, this drop of pressure, is related to this curvature. So, if we have a kind of this riverbed, actually this is called a chute, a flume, a chute, in italiano è uno scivolo.
When we have a curvature here, we can have a lower pressure. If we have a negative pressure, we can have cavitation not only on the spillway, but also on the chute. Indeed, usually you have the water surface here. Here we have the spillway. Then usually we have the chute here. So we have the problem of cavitation here, but we can have also the problem of cavitation here. Now, it is possible, in order to avoid the cavitation, so here and here we can have cavitation. In order to avoid the cavitation phenomenon, we can deploy the so-called air vent. So, a kind of structure able to fill this area with air. So, in a few words, I'm connecting the atmospheric pressure to the bottom of the chute in order to have at least a positive pressure. If I make a zoom here, I have this one, I have this one. Usually it is possible, just for example, to make a kind of modification of the chute. So this is not the case. So when the water flows, actually it jumps here, and the air can enter here. And then here we have not P lower than zero, but P almost equal to zero. Then the air are allowed to enter into the water. So in this case, the water flow, here we have the incoming water flow, and then we can have this one. Now, just as an example, we can say a phenomenon that occurred some time ago, I mean at least about 3 years ago. Here you can see a spillway, a long spillway. The shape of this spillway is the shape that we have described so far. Here we have another spillway in which under this part we have a similar OG, a similar shape, and this is the chute. Now, some times ago, this is a kind of emergency spillway. This is the actual spillway. But some times ago, 3 years ago, this spillway was damaged. And then the emergency spillway was activated. As you can see here, the water is flowing over the mountain here. Indeed, the damage suffered by this chute was most likely related to the cavitation. And I won't show you which can be the problem related to the cavitation. I just stop. As you can see here we have this strange phenomenon related to the presence of these piles. Indeed, here we have the water flow from different gates, and then these different flows interact. Indeed, as you can see here, you can see the effect of the piles here. And you can guess also the eigenvalue of the velocity. This is the emergency. You can just a little bit. Okay. So as you can see here, this is the shape of the speedway. Here the water is not white because I have not air. Here I have air. Indeed, the air is entrained into the water flow. And as you can understand, sometimes, in this case, this is an emergency speedway, the downstream part was not designed. Indeed, as you can understand, here we have a list of problems related to the emergency speedway. But this is not the really problem. The problem is this one. As you can understand, here we have a problem. I don't know if you can catch. So se riuscite a capire. Questa parte qui è quella che stavamo vedendo prima. Quindi questo stiamo guardando lo scivolo da sotto. Come vedete qui probabilmente c'è stato un problema. This is the chute framed from downstream. And as you can guess, here we had a problem. Let's try to understand. We can guess that here we have a change of slope. Then here, perhaps, we have a problem of cavitation. But let's try to understand what happened. Here you can see that something was wrong. Here you can see here the chute is almost working properly, but here we had a problem. You can guess the change of the slope here. So the problem was just downstream, the change of the slope. If we here again the emergency. So here the lining of the chute was damaged. You can see from the upstream the water is flowing into the spillway, and here we have a problem. So the spillway, or better, the chute was broken due to cavitation problem, probably. And actually, we have also other example of spillway. This is a particular kind of spillway that is called glory hole spillway. In Italian is sfioratore a calice. But you can guess that the shape of the spillway is always the same. So if you can say here, we have this shape that is almost similar to the previous one. And the water comes to this one. As you can understand, the shape is similar to what we have seen up to now. But coming back to the Oroville spillway damage, this is more or less 3 years ago, exactly 3 years ago tomorrow. As you can guess, this is the damage suffered by the spillway. So actually the water does not flow through the chute, along the chute, up to this, to the end of the chute, but damaged the chute, but also the land. And then the water flows through another path. But you can say, so as you can understand, here the chute was broken. Here you can see decavitation could be a big problem, a very big problem. We can go from here. This could be interesting. This is going downstream and it was broken, totally broken. And it could be very important for the safety reasons. Just to understand, in this case,
I think that about 200,000
of people was evacuated due to this problem, because this spillway is used to, in case of extreme events, to deviate water discharge from a lake deployed by means of an earth dam, and the earth dam cannot be overtopped. Indeed, if an earth dam is overtopped, it collapses. So, if the spillway does not work, the dam can collapse. So it is a big problem, and this is why a lot of people were evacuated. Quindi, per capirci, questo sfioratore è particolarmente importante quando fate le dighe in materiale sciolto. Se siete più o meno tutti quanti abruzzesi, le dighe in materiale sciolto, ne avete un esempio a Bomba, un esempio qua sopra a Campotosto, c'è una delle tre dighe che è in materiale sciolto. E il problema delle dighe a materiale sciolto, che funzionano molto bene, e che non possono essere sormontate, cioè l'acqua non può passarci sopra. Se la quota dell'acqua supera la quota del ciglio della diga, la diga cade. Quindi, in caso di eventi estremi, è necessario portare via dalla portata, e questo è uno dei modi con cui viene portata via la portata. In questo caso si è rotto lo sfioratore e si è rischiato il crollo di una diga, per cui hanno evacuato diverse centinaia di migliaia di persone per questo problema. Quindi capite quanto sia importante valutare tutti gli aspetti relativi anche alla cavitazione. Come vedete qui, la cavitazione ha fatto dei danni non indifferenti. Capite che ha tolto il rivestimento di calcestruzzo. E poi ovviamente il danno è andato avanti. E vedete che l'acqua poi si è trovata una via preferenziale totalmente diversa e ha scavato. Quindi adesso è stato difficile anche rifarlo questo sfioratore, che ovviamente vi dico è stato già rifatto. Comunque vedete qui praticamente il, come dire, l'erosione legata a questo tipo di fenomeni. Quindi non solo, è proprio sparito, come vedete non se ne vede più traccia. Non se ne vede più traccia. Per vostra curiosità, se cercate Oroville, non so se ve lo ricordate perché è andato in televisione per più di qualche giorno. Comunque vedete, praticamente qui è proprio sparito, è veramente sparito. Vi dico che già hanno accomodato tutto, ovviamente, perché qui si gioca con la vita delle persone, quindi non... It could be interesting... This is a kind of story of... So this is the dam. This is the dam here. And this is the spillway. We can say... So at the beginning... the emergency spillway should have been activated. But we had serious problem of erosion downstream. This is only one day, in one day, the situation. And then they reopened the spillway, and then the spillway was broken. It is interesting here, it is the shape of the spillway. then coming also here, the shape of the spillway that we have studied just right now, and this is the problem, as you can realize. You can come here, and just a last video. This is just to show you that in order to design spillways, also the structural part of the design is important. In this case, the shape is not equal to the shape that we have seen so far. Indeed, the shape can be also different. In this case, the coefficient mu is different. But if we look at this one, look at the central part of this video, you will see that a structural problem occurred. And then, of course, as you can see, here the flow stopped because the water flows from the central one. So also the structural point of view is important in the dimensioning into the design of this structure. And just a last video, this is the spillway, these are the piles, and here we have the gates. Indeed, when we deploy a spillway, something like that, we can also use gates here, so a kind of movable gates that you can use to manage the flow. So in this case we have a particular type of gate that is used to manage the spillway. The shape is the shape that we have seen. Here we can see the lining in concrete, and you can see also some aspect. This is the flow related to pipes located inside the spillway. But also you need to manage also the dissipation downstream when the gates are open. Okay, so just to understand that the problem can be different, and this is the river downstream. Okay, this is the time to finish.